विजय, आई विल गो लाइव प्लीज.
We are live.
Welcome to all the members of the White Army, and today we are very happy to have with us, ma'am. Welcome to you also.
Thank you.
Yes, and as we all know, ma'am has been topper throughout her examination, from starting from her MBBS days to her PG life as well. Ma'am has secured gold medal in 4 of the subjects during her MBBS days. She has secured top 10 rank in 7 of the subjects, and ma'am has got the best overall outgoing student in during her MBBS
4K course,
and
10 is very, very
during her PG course as well. Ma'am has been the best outgoing student from KMC Mangalore College, Manipal University, in MD General Medicine. So this is her brief intro, and hope you all make a very good use of this session. And once ma'am finishes presenting her slides, all of you can raise your doubts as well on the YouTube as well as on Zoom. We'll end up asking those questions to ma'am. So ma'am, can we start the session?
Yeah, Dr. Asai, more than everything, I feel she's a very good role model for all of us. Leading from the front, okay. Yeah, to be frank, not just securing rank is one thing, but more than that, she herself very much into teaching. Okay, she's so much keen and interested in teaching, and she'll be taking many classes in the White Army as well in the future. Okay, as soon as these exams get over, she'll be in her field of interest. She'll be taking classes for us also. So this is the special part. Okay, we have seen so many toppers, achievers, but they are so in a way they're selfish to like. But this is a special case. I felt Dr. Deepthi share her knowledge and her secrets, whatever the skills she has acquired, she wants to share with others and the guide juniors as well to in her path. This is something different and something special, I felt. So I felt this should be utilized for the benefit of our members also. When I requested, she kindly agreed to guide us, to help us, and teach the juniors. Really, really happy, and it's very privilege to have you, madam, with us today.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kishan and Dr. Ashray. Thank you for the kind words of introduction.
Yeah. Over to you.
Yeah. Good afternoon. Good evening, everybody. So today I'll be taking a short session on how to excel in examination. So excelling in examination is not something that is achieved overnight. It is a culmination of efforts you put in right from the day one. In the next few minutes of my talk, I'll be sharing my journey of how I faced my exam during my undergraduation and my post graduation days, and how each small step on the way proved to be helpful. I'll also try to share some tips on how to face the university practical and theory exam. So I have termed these the 6 stepping stones, the 6 stepping stones for excellence that will help you realizing in your dream. So 3 Idiots happens to be one of my favorite movies, and one quote which was said by Rancho really hit, stuck my heart. He says, excellence ke piche bhago, success ke piche nahi. So this attitude is very essential when we enter medical college, because securing marks in exams is not our only goal. Our goal should be to acquire knowledge so that we have the capacity and the confidence to treat the patient when they come to us. So always strive for excellence. See, knowledge is power, and this power can never be taken away from you. Hence, always try to read for knowledge and not just for marks. So the 6 stepping stones would be how to perform, how to utilize theory classes to the best, how to do your assignments well, how to approach clinics, how to prepare for the exams, how to face the theory exam and the practical exam. I would take a small, I'll discuss each of these aspects briefly and tell you, share my experiences on the journey as well. So now about theory classes. in this current era where online teaching and other teaching methods are taking over most of the classes, didactic lectures still remain an important part of our curriculum. Though attending theory classes may seem like a boring task, and most of us do it just for the sake of attendance, but honestly, in those 40 minutes, other than listening to the class, can we do anything else? Can you sleep in the class peacefully? No, you have the fear of getting caught. Can you read something else peacefully? No. Can you listen to some other class video peacefully? No. So the best idea would be to just try and listen to the class, however boring it might be, and try to catch 4 or 6 points in the class which you had not known before. And if you're able to catch these points, then the purpose of attending the class is served. Rather than just being physically present in the class, be present in the class mentally. And try to make notes of the class. Now, making notes in class is a great way to avoid yourself from falling asleep, especially in those post-lunch sessions. All of us have a tendency to fall asleep. So writing will prevent you from dozing off in the class and will also help you understand what the teacher is saying. And now, how to consolidate what you have learned in class would be, whenever you come back from your theory classes, make sure that you pin those points, what you have read, either in your textbook or your own notes. You might not have the time in the day to read the whole chapter, but the best way would be to just pin those points down, and later when you're reading, you will realize how important these points were which were taught in the class. Now, I will share a small example. In my second year, I used to find microbiology classes a little boring, but then, nevertheless, I made an effort to listen to them. So one of my professors shared one mnemonic on Neisseria species of bacteria. Now that mnemonic was not given in any of the textbooks, and since I found it interesting, I wrote it down and I pinned it in my book. Now later, many, like 4 or 5 years later, in Meet PG, there was the same question asked on this topic. And I was able to answer that question only because our teacher had taught that mnemonic. So an effort which is put with the right heart and mind will help you in every phase of your preparation. So these are the 3 things when you're attending a theory classes. Be mentally present, make notes of the class, and read those class notes once you get back home. So the next step is assignments. Now, all of us get assignments in medical college. Some of them are compulsory, some of them are optional. We do the compulsory ones, but most of the time we don't put our heart and soul while doing it. But trust me, however silly or boring an assignment may sound, a good job done with your full concentration can help you in more than one way. Also, whenever you get a chance to do any optional assignments, do them. Do not hesitate to take them up. Now, let me quote a small example here. When I was in my second year MBBS, I had got an optional assignment on cellular aging. Now, since I had found the topic interesting, I took up the task and I presented a seminar in class about aging. I had read some books of pathology, some books of medicine back then, and I had presented. Now, many years later, during my final year MD exam, there was a question on theories of aging. I had never got the chance to read about aging in my MD. So the only thing that helped me to answer this question was the seminar I had presented in my second year. So any good job done with the right intention will always help you in your different phases of your medical education. Not only this, during my first year of post-graduation, we used to have quite hectic duties and I never got much of a time to study. The only studying I did was in the form of seminars I presented during teaching program. So we used to have an internal assessment at the end of first year. And believe me or not, most of the questions from my internal assessment were from the seminars I had presented. And I could attempt most of them just because I had presented a few seminars on those topics. So what I'm trying to tell is, whenever an opportunity knocks, take it up. Because you never know in which phase of medical journey it will help you. Now, other than that, when given an opportunity to speak or present on stage, don't hesitate. Please do take it up. Because in this era, communication is the key for success. And you need to have communication skills in different spheres. It can be either communicating with patients or communicating with your colleagues or communicating to the lay press or public. So we need to hone our skills in all these spheres. And one of the best ways to improve your stage speaking skills would be to present more and more seminars when you're in your MBBS or MBA. So that's about assignment. I hope all of you are with me till now. So the next sphere, what I would like to concentrate is a very important one, that is your clinical postings. Now, clinical postings is something which all of us get. And Sir William Oster once told, he who studies medicine without books sails an uncharted sea. But studying medicine without patient is like not going to the sea at all. All of us are well aware of this quote. And any amount of studying in books cannot replace the learning we do in our clinical posting. Now, I'll share with you all a few tips that you can utilize to make your clinical posting more fruitful. The first and foremost of them is to make yourself aware of the knowledge and skills that need to be acquired in each semester. Now, what do I mean by this is, all of us get medicine postings in different years, like we have in second year, third year, and final year, depending on your college. So now, in each year, you are expected to learn a few skills. These are usually prescribed by the university, and it's advised that you keep yourself updated with what is expected out of you. Now, currently, RGHS is doing a major overhaul in the syllabus or the curriculum, and it is called as the RS4 scheme, but I'm not very much aware of the other universities. That RS4 has been released right now for the first and second years. For the pre-clinical and clinical years, it has not yet come out. So they may change the pattern of teaching in the forthcoming semester. But why this is important is, if you don't know what you need to read in this semester, you will end up reading the same thing or examining the same thing again and again in each semester. The usual trend is in the first clinical posting, whatever you go, like for medicine, in first clinical posting, we generally learn about history taking thoroughly and also general physical examination. You should know in and out of symptomatology in first semester. In the next posting, when you go, you're supposed to take complete cases and present them. And of course, in the last posting, whatever you get, you're supposed to present all the system cases like CNS, parabdomen, everything else. Now, if you don't know this, you may end up taking only fever cases or only parabdomen cases in each semester, which is not going to help you. The next is, don't be under the impression that you can present cases only when you have learned all the systems and are fully prepared for it. This is a myth and it will never happen because you can never be fully prepared for anything. Learning is a continuous process and our case-taking skills become better and better with each passing day. And they can become better only when you present more. So don't be afraid of making mistakes in clinical postings and always take cases right from the day one. Now, if there is a prefix timetable for your clinics, like suppose Monday, there will be a class by so-and-so faculty on so-and-so topic, or Tuesday, there will be demonstration of science by so-and-so faculty, make sure you follow that and go prepared for the next day. Being prepared for the class is a great way to retain what you listen in the class because it is like an overlapping memory. You read something, the next day they demonstrate the same thing, then you will never forget it for a very long time. Also, make yourself familiar with the cases that are considered as long and short cases for final exam. Now, this can vary depending on the college and the university, but these are the usual long cases and short cases. I won't go into the list because it's not a comprehensive one. But why I have put this up is you should take these cases to help you fare better in exam. Just taking fever cases or only taking parabdomen cases will not help you in the long run. You should take all variety of cases and be well versed with them. Now, few other tips would be learning the local language and dialect. This is very essential because not knowing the language should never be a reason for hesitancy for taking cases. Knowing the language and in fact, the slang in which they speak can help you connect with the patients better and they'll open up with you better. Develop the habit of taking cases and interacting with patients. This case-taking skill cannot be mastered overnight and just by reading one book, you cannot go and present a case in the next day's exam. The more cases you take during clinics, the more confident you will have while presenting during final exam. So also most of us think that, you know, patients will already know that we are students. Why will they cooperate with us and so on? No, it's not like that. Be compassionate and empathetic with them. Once they know that you have come there for the right reason, they'll definitely open up with you. Also, learn the art of communicating with patients by observing your teachers and seniors. See how they take history from the patient and see how they elicit the history from the patient. Okay. Apart from this, follow basic bedside etiquette. This I needn't tell in detail. This includes, you know, behaving in a proper manner in front of the patient, maintaining the decorum of the wards, not making noise. This is already known by most of us. Next thing is practicing demonstration of signs. This is very important. This practicing can be done either on the patients, or if you don't find a patient, then you can do it on your colleague. Because how much ever you read about eliciting a sign, you will never be able to do it unless you practice it. 100 times you can read about knee jerk, but one practice of knee jerk, you will understand what is the right way to stretch the knee, what is the right angle to keep the knee, what is the right force that is required, and everything else. So always practice demonstration of signs. Next is get to the habit of taking complete cases by yourself within a stipulated period of time. Never just go take history and come back, or just take do examination and come back. Because in final exams, you're supposed to take a whole case and you will have approximately 40 minutes to 1 hour to do this. So you should always take the complete case right from the name till the diagnosis and present it to yourself. If you are not comfortable presenting to yourself, present it to your colleague and do this without seeing case sheets. I say this because when you see the case sheet, you tend to read what is there and you don't apply your mind when you're reading it. So the best way to do it is to see it without the case sheet and to present the whole thing like a story. So I hope I gave you the basic idea of what you have to do when you're in clinic. Now, and always remember, your performance during final practical exam is a reflection of how well you have attended and utilized your clinical posting. Now, a few points of how to prepare or study for the exam. We all know that medical syllabus is very vast and completing it requires a lot of planning and preparation. Now, planning, discipline, and execution of the plan are the three key steps that will help you realize your goal. So first is envision. Have a goal. And always this goal needs to be backed up with a timetable. A goal without a timeline is just a dream. So start planning early on how you want to achieve your goal. Make a broad timetable for the year and do micro planning for the same, for each month or week, whatever suits you. Now, I usually do this as a plan for a month and then divide it over weeks. And then that week I divide for days. Now, also when you're planning, set realistic targets. You cannot say that I'll complete the whole CVS revision in one day. That is never going to happen. So you should set realistic targets such that, let us say now I have decided, and also set time-bound targets. Now, if I say I want to do CVS in 1 week, I will divide it into how many chapters of cardiovascular system. I'll do it today, tomorrow, and day after. Apart from that, I usually keep some buffer time. This is important because suppose on day one, you are not able to complete some 20% of chapter A. Then you can keep the rest of this chapter for those buffer days and prepare, read them then. If you have not completed a topic on one day, move on. Do not go on reading that topic. Okay. The next is consistency. This is important, and organization. These two are very important because have a method of studying. Like some people prefer writing notes. Some people prefer studying the textbooks and jotting down there. It depends and varies from person to person. I'm a person who likes to make notes and study because notes making is a great way to consolidate information from different sources. Now, at undergraduate level, it is advisable that you stick to a maximum of one or two standard books per subject. Do not go overboard, because medicine is a vast and a deep ocean. Not only medicine, all the subjects are a vast and deep ocean. You can never complete everything and you cannot achieve mastery over everything in undergraduate. The whole idea is to get a basic understanding of the concept and to make your foundation strong. So now, let us say you are reading from one textbook and you feel you want to refer another book B for that subject. Now, when you're referring a second book, you add on those points from that book into your main textbook. So that at the end of your study on just before exams, you just have one source to read. Before exams, you cannot flip through multiple books, multiple sources. You will be thoroughly confused. So the best way is to have one source which you can read just before exams and have an idea, mental idea of what to read from where. Okay. So consistent method of studying and being organized are a very key factors in preparing well. Next is accountability. Now, all of us make timetables. All of us, you know, will tell that today I'll do this, do that. But how to be accountable to yourself is keep a diary or a journal and in the morning, write down what are your study goals. Like what all are you planning to complete for that day? Now, and in the end of the day, come back and be honest with yourself and tell how much have you completed. This is a great way to keep a check on yourself. Because if you don't, then you will be like, no, I did so much the previous day. I can relax today. It is not going to happen like that. Always be accountable and honest to yourself. And always strive for progress, not perfection. This is because you cannot be perfect in any subject. All you have to know is get a basic idea of the subject. So aim for progress and not perfection. Now, these are the few basic points. But the most important one is integrating and studying. This is something which I realized in my final year of MBBS. And this is a very important way of studying because now let us say, for example, tuberculosis, you can take as an example. Now we read tuberculosis in so many subjects. We read it in micro, we read it in SPM, in medicine, in pharma, in patho, in OBG, in pediatrics and surgery also. So you read TB in so many sources, but you all you have to do is combine it and read it together. Like if I'm reading tuberculosis as an organism per se, I'll read from a micro book. If I'm reading the pathology, I'll read from the pathology book. So integrating and reading will give you a great idea of the overall picture of the subject and it avoids redundancy. You don't have to read the same etiology again and again in each subject. And it also provides good correlation between basic and clinical sciences. It helps you retain better and it helps in meaningful learning. So this integrating and studying is trying to inculcate this thing in our curriculum, but it has not yet come up in a very big way. If you do this integration for every topic, you'll realize how much repetition we have in each subject. This integration is very important, especially in your final year MBBS. So next is procrastination. Now, who doesn't procrastinate? Everybody does. So, but once you learn to master how to overcome procrastination, more than 90% of the job is done. So never procrastinate, never wait till the deadline to set you on fire and then do the work. Now, most of us have faced this situation, right? Like in exam paper, we see a question and we're like, oh yes, I have read this topic. And then your brain suddenly tells, oh no, I don't remember the answer. Now, why is this? This is because we don't revise properly. And to avoid this, all you have to do is revise, revise, and revise. Now, this is a small graph which shows how much we retain during our first time of studying. That is almost nil. But look at the amount we retain when we study for the third time. It is more than almost 80%. So this is just to show that repetitive memory always helps you to retain better. So revise, revise, and revise. This is the key process. It is important how many books or how many sources you study. It is important how many times you have revised the same book. Okay, and last but not the least is applying and demonstrating. Now, if I have read about a sign or a disease the day before, the next day go back to your wards or clinic and apply this on the patient. You can see that just lectures will help you retain only 5%. Reading is 10, but demonstration is almost 30. And teaching, this, according to me, is the best way to learn, which I love to do. Because whenever I read and understand a topic, I will grab hold of someone at home or one of my friends, and I'll bug them to make me teach them. Because when you teach, the concepts become solidified in your brain, and then you will never forget them. So always teach somebody. If you don't find something, go in front of the mirror and teach yourself. I have done this also many times. So always follow different ways of studying. Just do not just keep on reading, because that will never help you retain. So these are the things I spoke about till now about preparing. Now, the next important stone is, a stepping stone is how to write theory exams. This is very important. This I have divided into how you should manage your preparatory days, what you will do on the day, and how to write the exam. These are a few practical tips which I have found useful. You can inculcate whichever one of them you find it helpful. Now, during the preparation days, this is very important. You should make yourself aware of the examination pattern, the time, and the mark distribution. As I told you recently, the examination pattern for our university has changed. So make yourself well-versed with what is new, what are the types of questions you will get, and what is the distribution of questions, like how many long, how many short, and semi-long. Also, during preparation, try to cover maximum syllabus. And don't go into panic mode if you see new topics. If something is left behind, do not sit and read depths about it. Just read a simple textbook and pick up few key points. The idea is not to leave any question. You should answer every question meaningfully. Next, as I told you again, revise, revise, and revise. Nothing can stress the importance of revision nothing can beat the importance of revision that will help you write the exam to your best. Now, go through previous year papers. This is because not that the questions will be repeated, but you'll get an idea of what kind of questions can be asked and which topics to focus on. We all have preformed question banks now, which you can take the help of, but do not rely only on them. And this, I don't know how much it will, it is true for everybody, but at least this used to help me. That is going by my gut. Now, I had my anatomy second paper, and the previous day, we did not have any gap between this paper. And I somehow felt that I should read hip joint in detail. I don't know why, but I just felt that and I read. That was the only topic I read properly in the previous night. And of course, the next day morning, I read a few others. And to my shock, hip joint was the main question in my exam paper. So if you feel you have to revise something or if you want to read something, do not push it. Read it that day because you never know. Something will stay somewhere that this may come as a question. Okay. And on the day of the exam, this general tips about food and sleep, I won't give you much because you will always be well aware to eat properly and go to sleep properly and all. Be always on time to the examination center to avoid last minute rush and tension. And do not discuss unnecessarily with friends because that will create tension on things which you have not read or you have not prepared. What is done or what you have prepared till now is more than sufficient. Go with a calm mind. Keep all the essential items, including hall tickets, pens, all that. And make sure you have confirmed the examination time because sometimes the examinations are in the afternoon, sometimes in the morning. Be very sure of this. Do not, and also some exams halls will allow you to carry a few things. Make sure what is allowed, what is not. And if you're carrying any valuables, make sure you have arrangements for it. Now, when writing the paper, few important things is, most important, be legible. Examiners sitting there are not decoders who can read whatever we write. So be very legible. It needn't be calligraphy, but it should be legible. And use recommended colors only. It can be either black or blue. And usually it's a ballpoint pen. And do not change pens right on the day of exam. Use pens which have already been well-versed and are comfortable with. And presenting answers in exam is an art. You should present in a way which will attract the examiners. Also, divide the time for long and short answers accordingly and don't get too carried away while writing one particular answer. Divide the answer into sections for long questions. Always write in points. Avoid lengthy, long-drawn sentences. Draw flowcharts and diagrams. But make sure these you are thorough with what you are drawing and do not draw something which is not related. And always draw related diagrams. See, if they ask you something about an anatomist and axillary artery, don't end up drawing something like this for axillary artery. Draw related diagrams. Drawing diagrams doesn't mean just go on, keep on drawing anything and everything on the paper. Now, next is, most important thing is don't beat around the bush in exam and write to the point. We all know this meme that, you know, medical students are capable of writing anything and just filling the pages. Simply filling the pages is never going to get marked, and you should never think that you can fool the examiners just by filling the sheet. So if the question, let me give an example for being specific in an answer. Now let us say the question says investigation during the management of pancreatitis. Just do not enlist CBC, CT, MRI, ultrasound. No, you should write what is the expected abnormality in that particular investigation in that disease. And CBC, there can be anemia, there can be leukopenia, so on and so forth. In ultrasound, what can be there? And also write specific investigation for that disease. Like in case of pancreatitis, it has to be amylase and lipase. So be specific and be your content should be relevant to the question. Next, this we all know, never indulge in malpractices. Leave as soon as the exam is done and never discuss. Go back, get some rest. Don't recheck what you have written and always prepare for the next paper. I hope I made it clear through the how to face theory exam. And the last stepping stone is how to face your practical exam. Now, this is something which you will, as I told you, attending your clinics well is the first strong foundation you will lay on how to face your practical exam. Revise from standard clinical methods books. Do not go and revise from all the books. And do not waste too much time on resolving controversies in clinical methods, because some books may give palpation of liver in one way, some other books may give it in another way. Stick to one book, follow that, and that's it. Do not spend too much time on finding out what is right and what is wrong. Prepare for case-based discussion also. What I mean to say is, do not just read the systems and go. Reading all the systems is at one side, and another side is how to substantiate your differentials or how to give management for different cases which may come as your exam cases. Again, practice demonstration of clinical signs the day before, especially reflexes, parabdomen examination, respiratory exemption, all of them. Do not waste time finding out what cases will be kept the next day. Now, this most of us are guilty of doing. All of us really want to know what will be there tomorrow, who is going to, what cases are there, is the patient cooperative, that, this and all. No. Do not indulge in all of this. Just keep your mind calm, because you already know what are the common cases which will be there in exam. Go, and it's best if you don't know the diagnosis, because the examiner might not agree to the diagnosis given by you. So always go with the, never go with the preconceived notion of about the diagnosis of the patient. And next is never bother about factors which you cannot control. Like, who is going to be the examiner? Who is going to be the expert assistant? Will they help me during exam or no? No, this you can't control. This is left to God and faith. So do not bother and waste your piece of money. Waste your time on this. Okay? And most important, of course, take all the examination things like a knee hammer. With the list of things are all given in all the practical medicine books. You can refer there. And dress appropriately and be comfortable in what you are wearing. Wear a neat, clean apron. First impressions do last. Make yourself look presentable. Always eat and go. Now, hypoglycemia can deter anybody's performance. So never become hypoglycemic, because practicals are really, literally a very long drawn process, and they can start anywhere at 7 in the morning and end up till 5 in the evening. So make sure you have eaten well in the morning and carry something with you to eat. And while taking the case, do not panic on getting a case from the system that you're not well prepared. Let us say you're not well versed with CVS and you get a case which has predominantly CVS finding. Do not panic. Keep your mind cool. You will remember what you have learned in the previous year. You might be, this is very important, because your patient might still be examined by so many students again and again. And it will be the nth time you're examining the patient. So he may become irritable. Be patient and gentle with them and explain the situation to them. Try to talk in local language as much as possible and never look for help from experts and PGs. Always trust your findings, your judgment. Okay? Now, these are a few basic case sheet tips. I think I'll skip through this. There's nothing much. But one important thing I'd like to tell is, keep a summary of the history ready, because if the examiners are running a short of time, they might not let you present the whole case. And they may just ask you to summarize the history. So keep it mentally ready. And it is better if you write the summary in the examination sheet. And always provide differentials whenever you write the diagnosis. Okay. And if there is a time before the examiners arrive, present the case to yourself, preferably without looking into the case sheet. Okay. Now, while presenting and answering, present the history like a story. Write relevant negative history. This is very important. You cannot write every negative history for every patient. And most importantly, you should be able to justify why you have written that negative history. In what context is the negative history important in that case? Okay. And when asked to demonstrate a clinical sign, take the consent of the patient, describe and demonstrate simultaneously. do not bluff. If you have not done some examination, just accept that you have not done it. And remember, answers in an exam, in undergraduate examination, are expected at undergraduate level. You needn't answer the recent advances, the new trials that have come up in the field and all. No. So do not panic about you know, not knowing in depth about the topic. You should know the basics. Also, while answering, be confident, coherent, and audible. This is very important. Never cross a thin line between confidence and overconfidence. Do not show off your knowledge. If you don't know an answer, try figuring out logically and do not give too wild a guesses. Always keep your presence of mind. This is very important. I would like to share a funny incident that happened. In my first year of MBBS Viva OC, we all had this demonstration of, bone Viva table, okay? So where you have to pick a bone and describe about it. Now, one of my friends had got the chance to go and I was sitting behind. They had kept a stone to prevent papers from falling. And the examiner asked him, pick something. He picked up the stone and he started describing that this is patella, this bone helps in so and so and all. So if losing your presence of mind can make you do some real blunders, okay? And never be petrified of the examiner. This is not the actual way how examiners will treat us. So never be petrified of them. They have never come there to fail you, okay? Now, last, I would like to tell that if you work with a lot of hard work and sacrifice, but still you result in failure, do not get disheartened. Remember, hard work will always attract luck. Be passionate and be curious about your subject. So, thank you. I would like to take any questions if there are.
Ma'am, I have two doubts. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
First and foremost is why didn't we arrange this class long back when we are doing MBBS or so? Second is there any do you know is there any way after MCH can we go back and do MBBS again and I'm very sure it was mind blowing. I can't express in words actually. So Chris, crystal clear you made it. You didn't beat around the bush. You didn't go around and round. You point by point you made it so clear, madam. Awesome. Awesome. One of the best sessions I have ever had in my career also and in my white army also.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Ma'am, please what about the two questions? Please answer.
I couldn't see. Oh, how to score good in Viva OC and practical exams. Viva OC depends from most of the times what happens is Viva happens at the end of the practical session and the examiners would have already made an impression of how you have presented. So, but in Viva, always stick to the point. If they ask you about a drug in Viva, provide two or three relevant clinical points to the drug. You needn't start from telling the mechanism of action and every single thing. Answer to the point. And also in Viva, most of the examiners will be in a very jovial mood. I will like to share an experience with you all. Like in my MD final year Viva, I had gone for one particular table and that examiner was asking me who's the father of medicine, who's the father of all the subjects cardiology, nephrology and all. And in the end he asked me, who's your father? I'm like, sir, excuse me. So you should always keep your presence of mind because during Viva, most of the examiners will try to pull your leg or, try to deviate you here and there, but always keep your presence of mind and answer to the point. If you don't know something, go pick the next instrument or the next textbook because they will give you as many chances as you want. How to gain clinical knowledge, which we have lost during COVID time. I think White Army is a great platform to gain that because they have arranged so many sessions about clinical case discussions from medicine, OBG and all. So, and there are a lot of good online platforms where you can get. Of course, nothing can replace what you learn in clinics. But as for the time being, you can definitely go through what videos White Army has posted. That will definitely help you in your final exam.
And I have one more suggestion to add on. See, yes, first UGs, what they should know is the normal things. I totally agree with you. We should learn demonstrations and all. We need not go do it on directly on
exactly. You patients can do it on only.
We can try it on our home, who are there at home also. Yes. We can try it on parents. These reflexes and cranial nerve examination, maybe parabdomen examination, maybe. We can try it on our own people at home. First thing what we should know is normal things. See, there will be hundreds of abnormal things, hundreds of abnormal pulses. We can't know everything. But if you know what is normal, how the normal heartbeat sounds like, then all the abnormal thing we can differentiate. At least we can say it's abnormal, at least.
Exactly.
That's what's important for UGs. Yes, yes, for UGs, yes. You would not say it's an ejection systolic murmur, it's a mid-diastolic murmur. No.
Yes.
If you even just say it's a systolic murmur, it's more than enough. If you say there is some murmur which is, sounds like systolic, it's more than enough. So, yes, whatever you say, it's COVID or some SARS or whatever it may be, you are at home, safely at home, some 4 or 5 members are there at home, please try on them how to record the pulse, how to auscultate properly in a proper manner. What they see in your examination, not the findings, but your approach. Whether you are approaching in the right manner or not. You are Dr. Diti told, whether you are taking consent before you are doing every step or not. You should explain the patient what you are doing before.
Yes.
Even you don't done it while during the examination. But even when the examiner asks you to demonstrate something, please explain again.
Forget it.
Sir,
yes.
Please,
yes.
I am doing one like this on you. I am going to check there is a anemia or not. Can you please do like this? Just explain. That will give him reassurance and he'll be more cooperative. Okay, so very apt, very totally agree with all the points whatever you told, madam.
Thank you, members,
it's a very good opportunity for you all. Please make the good use of it. Ask many doubts and clear all your doubts. Okay. For PG students, we had separate session, Naveen. Okay?
Yeah, yesterday I think there was a session.
Yeah, we had today is only about UG examination. You can ask. Okay,
yeah.
We will arrange separate session by madam about that also. PG in another session.
Sure, I'll take.
Today you will we'll stick on to the UG examination because already theory is almost over. Practical is coming up. So in that we had this session. So just before going to the practicals, madam, can you please throw more light on the practical examination, please?
Yeah, as I told you all, you should now since you have exams coming up in the next few days. Make yourself aware of what cases are likely to be kept as long and short cases in your college or university, because that's usually a trend which will repeat itself. And do not read from multiple sources saying, this book has given like this, that book has given like this. Read from one standard book. And in the exam, if the examiner doesn't agree with what you are telling, accept it. Do not go and argue and say, sir, in that book, it was given like this.
Yeah,
that
is never, ever argue. Thing. Yeah.
Never argue in exam. Accept if examiner says something and be polite. And next thing about practical exams, as I told you, always be logically reason out your differentials. Do not give hundreds of differentials. For one case, one maximum 2 differentials are enough. The more you give, the more trouble you land into.
Yeah.
Especially this happens in case of CNS, where we tend to give hundreds of differentials, but that's actually like a math. Like this is there, and this is the possibility of the lesion. So do not give too many differentials.
And all the features should correlate with the differential.
Differential exactly.
Means if you're a swelling in a surgery, maybe there is a swelling. You can't give all the name out all the swellings. Okay.
Yeah,
the features,
exactly.
What are present and what are the differential you are given, like should correlate. Most of the features should be correlating. Only then, for some things, you need not even give the differentials. For example, hernia and thyroid. They're so straightforward. There need not be any other differentials at all. Even the examiners ask you some differentials.
Yes.
You need not tell any because they're very straightforward cases. Just because they have asked, you need not tell any. Madam, one important thing, what all we face in examination is writing the case sheet. Many we have the habit that typewriter, name,
yes,
gender,
yes.
You just keep on writing, asking and writing. Is that correct, the way, right? Or we hear the entire story, we do all the examination and sit back. And we will have a fair idea what's the case, what's the examination, everything. And write accordingly without any contradictory statements or without any... Because what happens in the history, it will be like a respiratory system. Looks like a respiratory system. But when we really examine, then we come to know that it's a CVS.
Correct,
so then the entire thing should be changed. History should be changed and examination. There will be no time. And
your case should become shabby. And I personally believe that you should first talk to the patient, examine, and then sit down and write. And you can, in between when you're writing, if you find something which is missing, you can then ask the patient. But, just first writing name, as sir told, do not do that, like where you go on writing each step by step, because that will take a lot of time and it will irritate the patient also. You say, what's your name? Write it down. No, that is not the way you do it. First, completely take the history, do a brief examination, and then start writing. Because you may suddenly find that you don't have the time to complete the case sheet. finish the relevant system examination and start writing it off. And once you're done with that, then if you feel some gaps are there in your history, then you can ask the patient again and write whether you know, some negative history if you want to ask, then you can ask there and then and there and write about it. But do not do this part and piece business.
For a person who remembers 18 subjects, it's not very difficult to remember the facts of one person in the examination. Okay, so don't feel that you will forget the details of the patients or history of the patient. Never. Okay. Yes. And patient doesn't know that you are a student. He always thinks that you are a doctor. Saving him. So please look at his concern first. Don't directly go and start with your pro forma. What's your name? What's your gender? Even some people even ask the gender also. Okay, don't do that. Just pat on the back and grandma, how are you? Did you have your food? Then please take them to your confidence first. Okay, otherwise what happens? So many people would have examined him or her, or so many people have taken history. They become very restless and they become very uncooperative at the end. So they may not, they tell something else, or they'll heard some juniors telling, sir, when I took the case, he was repeatedly going to bathroom. He was not at all cooperative. Yeah. All those
and
things happen.
Sometimes patient will twist the history just to, if you annoy them, they may twist the history.
Yeah.
That happens many times. You should always take them into confidence and tell them.
Yeah.
If they know already that you are a student, then you better make it clear to them that you have an exam. You are come here to examine them. And it's best if they cooperate with you. Sometimes patients are smart enough because, you know, some colleges have this habit of calling those same patients again and again for exam purposes only. So that time should be very smart to deal with
those kind of patients. We had a psoriasis patient who used to come from 15, 20 years. He used to tell us all the answers also, what are the questions posed. And what used to happen, we used to give, in our time, I was in BMC, used to give some 200, 250 rupees for long cases and some 50 rupees for the short cases.
I think that is there
some clever people to save money, they used to never give money, okay, after the case. So next fellow who will take the case would have nicely.
He's
because
screwed.
He's screwed. So don't do all these selfish things. Okay.
I know.
So any more questions, please? Madam is answering really well to the points. So ask questions.
I have some questions here. Which topics to study from Harrison and not Davidson? Now, during undergraduate days, I don't know how much Harrison you will be able to grasp, because Harrison is a book which needs to be, you need to understand the beauty of it only when you know the basics. I tried studying Harrison during
the UT book.
And yes, I could never complete Harrison. I stuck to Davidson most of my UT days, and I even referred API textbook of medicine. But I would suggest not to go for Harrison during UG. But if you still want to go, you can read systems like renal and CVS and CNS from there. Not in fact renal, actually CVS and CNS are given good. But I would suggest to avoid Harrison during your final year MBBS, because you will not be able to understand a lot of it.
What I would like to say is, it's a reference book. Okay,
yes,
there are two types of books in UG. One is textbook, one is reference books. Okay, textbook, which we read from page 1 to page 100 or page 1000. Okay, that one book we will have and we'll read it thoroughly in detail. And these references books are for those topics which are very important or which we want to know in detail. For example, infective endocarditis. It's a must 10 marker. It's a 10 marker, pucker 10 marker for UGs. Such things, you can refer such standard books or reference books, or make a jot down the important points
point.
In your textbook or in your notes. Okay.
Yes.
For example, another maybe in the surgery, maybe thyrotoxicosis is a very important question.
Mm-hmm.
Read it from the Bailey and make it a note in your other book you are reading. Okay. So these are all called reference books. You can't read page 1 to page 100 or entire system or entire things. One important topic you select and topic wise you select. Okay. If you need that important topics, madam, we'll request madam to make a list of important topics in and we'll
for
undergraduation
days. Yes, okay. we'll share. Yes.
Yeah.
And that's what I was trying to tell. Just keep your sources limited. Do not go overboard with reading too many books, and always consolidate what you have read into one book. Like if your book is Davidson, whatever new point you have read from Harrison, please add it on from there. You cannot read the whole Harrison and Davidson before exam. That is never going to happen. Always consolidate and add points from one book to one particular book. That's the best way to do it. And as sir said, topics which are important like infective endocarditis or pneumonia and all, you can do from Harrison. Okay.
And it's not the which book or what book you read is important. How many times you read the same book is very, very important. Okay.
Yes, very
because
important.
Almost all these other Indian authors or whatever their books all copied from almost like it's notes of
the all standard books.
Okay. So you can read any book which suits your study style, okay, and stick on to that and revise repeatedly. Revision is very, madam, please tell our members 2 points about revision, how important it is.
Yeah, I was
because our memory, because scientifically we can tell how our memory works, how the short-term memory should be converted to long-term memory.
Yes.
On that basis only you can tell them, please.
Yeah, that's what I was just telling right now, because I stress so much on revision. That's because you read something today, you will remember it at the max for 3 days. But if you revise the same thing today and the next, again, if you read the same thing tomorrow, then the retention will go on more than week to 10 days. So that's what I'm trying to say. Whenever you read, you make sure you have a plan for revision also. Now, this revision needs to be spread out on both short-term and long-term basis. Short-term revision would be like what you have read today to revise it the next day before starting your session. That is a short-term revision. So just a quick revision of what you have done. A long-term revision would be probably, let's say, by the end of the month, you keep 1 or 2 days to revise the whole topic or all the topics, what you have read in that whole month in a very brief manner, just to see what are the lacunae, where you're lacking or how much you have read. So, but you know, you can have your own revision strategy on how to do it. And one more thing is to solve questions. Now in your MBBS, you may not, if you start solving MCQs right from now, it will help you not only for your NEET PG, but will also help you correlate better. I'm not telling about solving this one-liner kind of an MCQ. Solve clinical-based questions, because that will help you retain the things better and you will realize where you stand in that particular subject. Anything else on revision? Is anybody requesting?
Ma'am, and that asked, in case of they're in third year, should they start reading fourth year beforehand and start preparing for that, or concentrate mainly on third year?
I would suggest you can start, because third year there's a lot of time to read. I had personally started infectious diseases in medicine and one or two systems from medicine when I was in third year itself. And even for surgery, as I told you, I used to always integrate and read. Now, if you see gastrointestinal surgery and GI medicine, there are a lot of overlapping things. Like inflammatory bowel disease is given in both the topics. And so many things are there like this, which are there in both medicine and surgery. So you can start to integrate and read when you are in third year itself. And it is advisable to start reading final year subjects, but do not keep a specified time for how much to read or how much final year subjects to read when you are in third year. Keep a goal of one system or, you know, two systems at the max. Best would be to complete infections in third year, because you'll have SPM, which again has a lot of epidemiology and infection. And in medicine, again, you have a lot of infections. So if you club both of them and read, it's a great way to complete that whole infectious disease system in third year. I don't think OBG and all you need to start so early. You can wait it out till your final year. And pediatrics also, you can wait it out. Mainly medicine and surgery, you can start in third year. Okay?
And they asked for Viva questions, should we like answer to the point or give in description the answer to be in?
See, Viva depends, because sometimes Viva questions will be given like a sheet. They will tell you what you have to write, like describe, like if you have quarters in Viva, then they would have written what is the, you know, what is this instrument and write two uses of it or give two uses of it. Then stick to the point. Depends on how the examiner asks. It doesn't mean if the examiner says, tell us about management of this condition, then you can go ahead. But most of the time, Viva will never happen like this. It is a very to the point oral examination which happens. You needn't revolve around, you know, telling about etiology, pathology, all that. No, that is not required.
If the management is asked, only management we should tell.
What is asked, on to the point. Yes.
Yeah.
If they say manage pancreatitis, you cannot go on saying the etiology of pancreatitis and then come down. No, that will take away a lot of time.
And in practical exams, see, for in the beforehand, be prepared. In some cases, some specific things has to be done. Okay. Like, for example, in hernia, for you get a hernia case. Okay. Some, there are 5 tests which must be done in case of hernia. So those things should not be missed. Okay. Should not get so be in, even while writing the theory exams also. Some in a question for an answer, there will be some 5-6 technical keywords. Okay. That should be written. Then how is your grammar, how much pages you have written, that nobody is going to see. So if they will be examiners will be looking never for only those around 6 or 7 keywords. So if you have mentioned that, you will get minimum 7 or 8 out of 10. Okay, then the remaining, how to make a sentence, how to write a story, we need not tell you, or nobody need to teach you. All
everybody
those
knows that. Everybody is not
that. All, they're all toppers of PSM at least.
Yes. When to start PG. I think we'll take a separate class on PG preparation on when to start, how to take. There's a lot of questions about PG preparation. We can take that as a separate session.
So, madam, we'll be eagerly waiting for your next medicine classes, madam.
I will
have on rheumatology, immunology, and we'll have a series of classes on a fixed date. We'll have a series of sessions. This is just an introductory class today to get a taste out of your knowledge to our members. Okay. And what a wonderful indeed. We are really feeling happy about ourselves for having conducted this session.
No, thank you. I would really like to thank Vitami for giving me this opportunity. And I would like to take a minute of your time, because all this excellence in exams can never be achieved without the support of your family and my wonderful colleagues in post-graduation and my colleagues in undergraduation. So I'd like to thank them all for giving me such a wonderful support to achieve this. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, on behalf of all our members and all our viewers, I would wholeheartedly extend our thanks to Dr. Deepthi, and who has spent her valuable time with us for guiding us.
Thank you so much, Dr.
Giving new insights thank about better preparation methods for UGA and undergraduate examination. Thank you so much, madam. We will be disturbing you again and again. Please keep guiding us.
We'll meet again. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Definitely. Thank you.
And thank you, Dr. Ashray and Vijay, for hosting the session. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
So, members, we indeed had a very great session. We indeed, actually, we had two toppers. Ma'am, as already mentioned earlier, and we had Kishan also with us. Sir himself has been topper in his UG exams as well as all the entrance exams. So, thank you both of you for guiding all of us.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you, members.
Thank you.